Good evening, everyone. So good evening, everyone. Welcome to this session on motorsports in India. It's the Sports Star South Conclave, and South India is the cradle of motorsports in India. I mean, we have the two tracks, the old Sholavaram track and the new Irangattukottai, which is active FIA Grade 2 circuit. And apart from that, we have the Coimbatore 1 in Kari Motor Speedway. And also, the contribution of South India into Indian motorsports is, I mean, we have Narain, the first ever Indian in Formula One. The second Indian, Karun Chandok, is also from this part of the country. Obviously, Santosh is here, Dakar Rallies, the first Indian. Arman has done F2 and A1 GP, and now he's, you know, having a different hat as an organizer of motorsport events in the country. And to get the Federation's perspective, Mr. Balakrishna Jayasimha is here. So, first and foremost, I'll start with Narain. Narain, 2005, you made your debut with Jordan Grand Prix. That's a seminal moment in Indian motorsports. That was the first time an Indian had scaled the highest levels of motorsports. So, for 17 years hence, how do you look at the state of motorsports in India right now? We've had the Indian Grand Prix, obviously, and hopefully we'll have the Formula E race next year, I think. Arman's father, Mr. Akbar, is in the World Motorsport Council meeting today. It could be ratified as early as this month. So just talk us through motorsports in India and where it is now.
Yeah, I mean, good evening, everybody. And, you know, happy to be here amongst you all. Yeah, it is working, right? Yeah, 2005, you know, for the entire motorsport fraternity and, you know, to make my debut in Formula One was, you know, a proud feeling. And obviously, you know, it is never easy to get to that level of the sport. And as we speak, you know, Jehan has become the third driver from India to get the coveted super license, which enables him to, you know, drive in Formula One if he's to be chosen by a team. So things have, 17 years ago is a long time. And, you know, as I told you, motorsport, yes, it had a kind of uplift during, you know, when Force India was there, when there was an Indian driver, and obviously the Indian Grand Prix, after which, you know, it went, you know, it's been, you know, stagnant, I would say. But now, you know, we have a former driver, a very capable man in Akbar, and he's the president of the CIK, the karting body, and it's a huge achievement in terms of it's almost like he's at the pinnacle of the karting regulations and so on. So we hope that for developing nations such as us, him being there will help the karting industry grow, and that's how you're going to get young drivers coming into the sport. And so at this moment in time, it's a very good situation to be in, I would think.
You spoke about karting. How was the karting scene when you started out, and where has it evolved to the level where we can push out world-class karting drivers into Europe?
Yeah, when I started, there was no karting, nothing at all. And I think Arman was the first generation of the Indian drivers to go through the karting system. Rotax Championship has been in India ever since 2004. Now there is this IMA Championship coming as well. So yes, the most important thing is the affordability. That's the most important thing where we have to see how to make it more accessible to kids who want to take up this sport, as karting itself is very expensive right now. So so that's where it is.
You can talk about karting since Narain said, and I just want to get your perspective on what is holding back. Is it the quality of machinery that we have, the high import duties that we have to get high quality karts into the country? Why are we producing high quality? Because it's very expensive. You can't expect a young family to uproot themselves, go to Europe and do the karting scene. Wouldn't it be better if you could have a high quality karting circuit in India, so that at least when they go to single seater, they are quite, you know, well developed in racing and everything?
First of all, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me here. Thanks, Sportstar. Rightly, like you said, for sure, you've ticked all the boxes. But again, you know, it takes a lot of infrastructure. It takes, you know, a lot of funding to have something of that sort. And, you know, the first Rotax Championship was started in 2004, which was 18 years ago. And since then, you know, it's been a roller coaster. You've seen ups and downs. But I think, you know, this year we've got about a total of 62 kids, you know, over the three categories. You know, so that's quite a big number for, you know, where you only have two eligible karting circuits for that category at this point in time. We have another championship that is starting. So, you know, it's taking time. But now you have two national level, national championships, which are of an international standard. You've got nine professional teams that are competing in this championship, you know, so where they go and get drivers and offer deals and, you know, nurture these young talents. You know, I'm talking about kids who are starting at the age of, you know, 7, 8, you know, and they race in cars right up to 14 or 15. So, you know, you're really nurturing them and, you know, trying to looking after their parents as well and trying to educate them what the sport is. But again, for the longest time, there was nothing after that, you know. What do you do after karting? You need to get into cars. But then, yes, you had the domestic championships, post which the drivers were kind of lost. Okay, there were a few of us, you know, who lucky enough had the back end and whatnot, and we were able to get sponsors and make our way in the international foray of motorsport and, you know, find our way to whatever level best we could. But then again, how many people can do that? How many people have that exposure? Or how many people's parents who are willing to give that time and effort and, you know, sacrifice to do so? So for a long time, there was a big gap. There was a lot of domestic racing that was going on, but no one was actually taking that step and going forward. There were here, I mean, every three or four years, there were one or two kids who were doing it. Which then when we launched the league in 2019, just again to create more accessibility and, you know, have an international sort of face to motorsport and mix it up a bit. And obviously the idea came forth when we've seen how successful and what leagues have done for other, you know, genres of sport in the country. But for whatever happened, I think what we learned was that, you know, if you have something India-centric at a professional level and an international level, there is a lot of interest. Not only on site, because at both circuits, we had at both and Chennai, we had a big crowd that came. But also, I think in terms of television viewership, we were second to MotoGP and Formula One. In four-wheelers, we were second to Formula One, which really surprised us as well. And, you know, what that did, okay, after that, there was COVID. So the 2 years of COVID, actually what it helped us do is showcase that value to, you know, people who were involved, maybe our franchises and whatnot. And then from there on, we run a team in, you know, the Formula Regional Asian Championship, where we end up running two Indian drivers in the first year, and, you know, this year we actually won the championship as Mumbai Falcons Racing Limited. You know, so an Indian team actually won an international grade Formula 3 Formula Regional Championship. But more importantly, what that did is it showed these people that there is potential in this country for motorsports. So, you know, we got promoters on board. Now India's evolved where you have two professional karting championships that are going to be running, multiple circuits that are being built. You know, one Naren will tell you more about himself, because that is again, you know, world class venue that is coming up. Plus there are others in the pipeline. Karting circuits are being built as we speak. There's going to be, you know, three championships that are starting end of this year, which is the, you know, in the Indian Formula 4 Championship, the Indian Formula Regional Championship, both certified by FIA, and then the Indian Racing League. You know, and when you say certified by FIA, as just to add another point, to get to Formula 1, you know, when you say he's eligible for Formula 1 now, a driver needs to have scored a total of 40 points over various of junior FIA certified championships over his career. In India alone, if the driver wins these two championships, he has 30 points. He or she has 30 points before they venture abroad. You know, this itself is a huge starting point and gives them a lot of backing, because when your broadcast is live and when you're racing in India itself, I think converting sponsors is a lot more easier. It's a lot more. It makes a lot more sense for corporates, because it happens in their backyard. It makes, you know, marketing sense rather than you know, having a sticker and a card on an athlete that's performing in, I mean, he's just competing in Europe and there's no real coverage here. So this is the first step we've taken. It's taken a long time, I agree. But you got to start somewhere, and you know, it's because of people like Naren, Karun, and then what we've done in the back, and we've been pushing for a long time, you know, and trying to develop the sport. But hopefully this will be a new chapter, and this will really change the face of motorsport and elevate us to a mainstream sport where parents are already starting to look at it as, you know, a profession for to get the kids involved in. In various levels, whether being a driver is one, but also in terms of the technical side as well. But hopefully this will be the change. You know, this year will be the change where motorsport elevates to that mainstream sport and becomes to what you envision it to be, or what you were asking us, why is it not there yet? So, yeah.
From four-wheelers, let's move to two-wheelers. We have Santosh. Santosh, if for people who don't know, he survived a near-fatal crash at the Dakar rally a couple of years back. So it's medical, a lot of scientific advancements has brought him here. So just Santosh, just talk us through your career. You started pretty late in two-wheeler rallying, you know, getting into 18 and still making the Dakar rally is one of the world's most toughest endurance rallies to ever do. And to do it on two-wheelers is even more tougher. So if you could just talk us the challenges and what do you want to, you know, improve so that more people get into, you know, Dakar. You did, KP Arvan did, but we've stagnated. Much like what Naren did and Karun, there's been a lull. And after you and Arvind, there's not been many people doing that. So just talk us through your experience and what do you want from the Federation to change?
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, sports staff, for having me here. And privileged to be sitting with these gentlemen. So thank you so much. Like you mentioned, my claim to fame, of course, is the Dakar Rally and me being the first Indian to participate and then finish that rally. So that's why I'm pretty much known all across India, and that's why I am. When you talk about motorsports, of course, in India, the first thing that comes into mind is that it's an expensive sport. And of course, in India, it's more prominent because we are India, but India is progressing. And that progression has been reflected in a way that I ride for Hero, which is, of course, the world's largest manufacturer of motorcycles. So the fact that motorsport is expensive, we also have an industry, like in the two-wheel segment, which is being the world's largest manufacturer of motorcycles. So I think a lot has to be done in terms of the grassroots level of motorsport, and it's important that we all play an active role in it, in the sense, when I say we all, in the sense, not just the athletes. Of course, there are drivers and riders that this sport is magnanimous and it's fantastic, but also of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people are available to participate in motorsports through colleges. Say, for example, if it's technology or engineering, all of them also can have a career in motorsports, not just restricted to guys like us. And so we should basically do that, take it to the forefront in terms of growing this development and make it a holistic industry. So yes, we need to be able to move that aspect of it. And also, I take a lot of cues from Prakash Padukone and Gopi Chand in terms of what they did. We have Sanya Nehwal today. I mean, it just didn't happen because of what they built. And that's what I'm trying to do with Big Rock as well, trying to grow that aspect of motorcycle riding. And it's going to grow the sport in terms of racing as well. But first, as a community, as the culturally, we need to basically build that and start right from the grassroots level. So I think we need to do all of these aspects of what is needed in India. And of course, I think it's very promising the fact that the country is moving forward economically as well. And I'm just a reflection of what my country's been able to achieve. Because in a sense, I'm just a normal guy. My parents don't come from a motorcycling background. There's no interest at all. I'm just a guy that had adventure in his DNA. They wanted to experience that. And I experienced the Dakar in motorsports. So there are thousands and millions of guys like me that want to experience motorsports as well. So we need to take that forward in terms of growing the industry holistically and starting from the grassroots.
Naren, Santosh obviously spoke about his driving school. You were one of the pioneers with the Speed NK Racing Academy. So what are the challenges you faced in, you know, nurturing that academy? He spoke about the Gopi Chand Padukone thing. So you did around 2008. You were quite early to that as well. So what are the challenges you faced and what are the challenges you have in terms of getting machinery and the red tape around machinery to produce, you know, proper carts? And what can be changed to, you know, do a proper riding school, driving school, things like that in this country?
Yeah, it's you know, it's a huge challenge because the accessibility, the amount of money it costs to just set all this up is very, very expensive. So affordability is a big factor. And both Arman and I, we run teams in the National Karting Championship. Of course, we are trying to nurture the next set of young drivers coming out of India, similar to what Santosh is trying to do with Big Rock. I mean, the bottom line is when you want to import stuff. Firstly, motorsport was recognized by the Indian government, I think, five years ago, right? And
change things in terms of imports and red tapes and everything?
Not really. This is where the Federation needs to kind of, you know, get their, you know, just writing letters and, you know, thinking it's going to be resolved is not going to happen. So there needs to be a proper lobbying. There needs to be a system. And you need to, you know, help us to develop the next set of drivers by making it affordable. So that is the bottom line. So that is something that, you know, has to be done very seriously. And if they need external help, yes, we're all there to help. So, you know, we can represent or whatever. But, you know, making things stop, just, you know, sitting and, you know, waiting for them to say, okay, you're recognized now as a sport, and expecting these concessions is not going to happen. This is something that needs to, you know, first happen. Yeah.
Then I'll ask Mr. Balakrishna, what are the challenges in getting, you know, lobbying the government to, you know, consider making importing some of these, because all these equipments, not everything can be indigenized. So a lot of something has to be imported, at least to begin with. So what are the challenges you face? How active are you with the sports ministry and, you know, trying to reduce the, because the reason the Indian Grand Prix left the our country was the bureaucracy, the tax, the red tapes and everything. So especially even when getting the Formula One cars into India and getting out, there's a lot of issues with custom duties and customs clearance and everything. So what can the Federation do, and what are you, you know, doing, and what are the plans that you have in terms of how's your relationship with the sports ministry and things like that?
Let me answer your first question. That is, are we active with the ministry? Yes, we are active with the ministry. But we need to understand one thing. You know, this is a sport which involves even the common man. I mean, you know, everybody drives cars, everybody rides two-wheelers, right? So in that sense, it's quite different from the other sport. So when it comes to policies, when it comes to decision-making, the government or the ministry, for example, more so the government, needs to keep the federation in mind. You know, let me give you a couple of examples in terms of taxes, right? Initially, before the GST came, to import technical parts, which are very, very expensive, was only about 5%. Today it's 28%, right? So what happens is people who buy these parts, people who are in the sport, not everybody are companies, they are individuals. So they can't claim input taxes, right? There we go. Helmets. The government says we need the ISI mark. I mean, some of the helmets that these guys know better than me, they're the best helmets you can get in the world in terms of safety, right? So without the ISI mark, you can't. So importing helmets has become difficult, right? Let's take tires, okay? Tires was on free entry before. Now it's on the restricted list. So how many manufacturers are there of competition tires in this country? 2-3 manufacturers, right? So people are finding it difficult to import tires. Okay, and they're costing a lot. Infrastructure. Most of the sport happens in tier 1, tier 2 cities. You know, and we have a lot of off-roading events. So to get permissions, going to the district collectorate, you know, the state government or the central government, making people know about this sport is extremely important. Right?
Can you then sensitize the government on the multiplier effects of what a motorsport event has for a local community or a society or the local businesses there? Can you do that? Can you do it in a more active way?
We can do that. We can do that, definitely. So that's the reason we are saying, we are urging the ministry, or we are urging even the government, by saying that, look, you need to keep us in mind when you're taking this broad-based, you know, across-the-board decisions, because it's affecting the sport. right? So there has been correspondence, there has been up and down thing, but then, you know, yeah, it needs to get a little bit more louder. And that's the reason, I mean, we're very happy that we are here in the mainstream today, thanks to Sportstar and the Hindu group, that they have us here so that our voice is heard.
Okay. And Santosh wanted to say something. And before that, Santosh, I also, considering we're speaking about federation government,
yes.
I recently learned from a big motorcycle manufacturer that Indian kids can't start racing until, I mean, the age restriction has come down to 13 now, and it was much higher. But compared to our peers in Southeast Asia or Europe, where they can start on small pit, it's called pit bikes, right?
Bikes, yes.
So they can start at 8 and 9. So you can tell me, like, how, because if you start at 13, how far behind we are, and is it easy to catch up? So
sure, I get that question. So I just want to address one aspect with the federation. Like, say, for Hero. Hero used to make the most, the bike with the highest mileage, 87-90, and people used to buy the Splendor. And today, India is now a place where they make performance motorcycles. Hero is making bikes for performance aspect, and basically the middle class, so the upper middle class, can afford these motorcycles. And the fact is, we want to be able to use these motorcycles and our skills. And where can we do it? There are no venues or places that are prominently distributed all across the country to avoid catastrophic situations. Like, for me, example, 25 years ago, when I bought the Shaolin for the first time, I was racing on the road and I had a big crash. And luckily, I'm alive. But this is a fact that the federation should be able to have conversations with the government, because it's a necessity because of the industry. It's not just people like us that want to race. It's the common man that wants that as well. So we should definitely have those conversations with the government, saying that we basically have to take care of these needs, because it's not safe for individuals or people at the end of the day. So that is one aspect that I'd like to say. And like you said, yes, riding a motorcycle, of course, you start when you're, like in America, 4 or 5 years old. So it's ingrained, it's almost like you're walking. So yes, we need to start really, really young to be able to be a really good rider internationally, not just in India. And you want to compete with the world at the end of the day. It's not just the best of being the best in India. You want to compete with the world. So that can only happen if we lower that age to allow kids to be able to pursue their passion. And make that possible is to have kids' bikes, which are pit bikes. So hopefully we can do that. I mean, of course, the duties and all that are there, but that is a possibility that we should address in India as well.
Then finally, one of the biggest things, that the perception battle that motorsport faces, it's an elitist sport. It's only for the rich. I mean, end of the day, I mean, let's be realistic. In the motorsport, it's not never going to become the cheap, like accessible, like football or cricket. It entails a certain amount of cost. But can we reduce the entry barriers to so that middle class and upper middle class can also aspire and, you know, start, you know, getting into the sport? And what are the things that the small things that can make huge impacts? Something.
Yeah, of course, affordability is something that starts with the basic import duties, which I think we end up paying with the GST is around 60% by the time a go-kart comes to compete here. So, you know, you're talking about, you know, parts for aeroplane, for aerobatics, those kind of sports. In India, I've got an exemption. So this is something we need to do. Of course, we have a very capable man at the top, the president of the FMSAI, Akbar. And the entire system, the federation needs to support him and give him the thing to the all the support to go out there and get this done. This is the affordability is the biggest factor that is restricting the sport.
Is it making it costlier?
It is getting more and more expensive because worldwide, everything motorsport is an expensive sport. Yes, but like you said, why not open it up for the more general public? Yes, it can be done, but this has to be addressed first, and if not, it's going to be very difficult.
I think from a personal level and individual level, if you look at corporates, companies, teams such as us, I think we may, and the federation as well, in terms of entry fees and whatnot, make it as affordable as they can for, you know, people to take part, to compete in. So I think as individuals, as a community, we're doing our bit to try and make it more affordable. We're always looking for scholarship programs, you know, for winners, and creating a ladder and a system. That has been, you know, regularly trying to beat that every year and try to make it more and more affordable as we go on. But like, you know, everyone on the panel has said, the only hindrance right now is the duty factor, because again, most of the equipment comes from abroad, right? And that is the biggest hurdle that you face because you can't change that. So, and when things start getting competitive, obviously everyone is only wants the best equipment. No one's going to be satisfied with something that's secondhand because, again, in motorsport, you're fighting for every hundredth of a second. You know, every little thing makes a difference, right? So, it's a positive in a way, but it's also a negative. I mean, it's something that's really difficult because when you're so competitive and you're fighting for the edge of every little millisecond, then you have to have the best. And for that, it's again, everything comes from abroad. So that's where the duty comes in. And that if that is reduced, then that will open a lot more doors in various fields of the sport, I think.
Yeah, just to add, Deepak, the FMSC has also started what is called as the Grassroots Commission. Okay. Now, they're talking about professional racing, but we're also talking about, getting people in a car park. Okay. You visit a mall, there's somebody running an event, they see that it's grassroots. You have a common man driving the car. He just feels like taking part in the event. Yes. So things are being put together in terms of getting the grassroots level going. And for that, we have kind of, reduced the licensing barriers. You can just buy the license for that one particular event. And that has helped quite a bit, okay, in terms of the growth of the sport. In fact, when table tennis said 5,000 registrations, I was happy that we issue close to 4,000 licenses a year. Yeah.
But how do we channelize that into, elite levels of success?
Sorry?
How do we channelize the huge entries? You spoke about 4,000 entries, but how do we channelize that number into, quality competitors going abroad? How do we nurture that?
It's the beginning, Deepak. I mean, it takes time, right? I mean, so like what we said, you see the number of events that are taking place right now, they have increased. The number of people who are entering has increased. The number of licenses that we are giving out is increased. It takes time, yes? And of course, like the badge that you said, that yes, motorsport is expensive. That takes time for people to, get to know that, yes, I can do it too. So, yeah.
Naren, obviously we here. I don't want to leave without asking about Formula One. The last couple of years has been great for Formula One. Obviously, whatever happened last year, the championship went down to the wire. Just your quick thoughts on state of Formula One motorsports. Formula One said entered a new era this year, closer racing. So, just quick thoughts on that.
Yeah, absolutely. Last year, what happened in the last race was absolutely unfair. And Lewis deserved to win that race. And if he won that race, he would have been world champion, yes.
Close racing and finally, we've had a close championship last year at least. That was a positive.
Yeah, but it wasn't fair. It was, decisions that was not sport. And it was outside of sport. That was what was not the good thing. But anyway, it's becoming more Americanized. They're going to three races there. It's becoming very popular again, Formula One. So Netflix has helped a lot for sure. And it's going to become bigger and bigger. Yeah.
No, but how do you see the current season unfolding?
Well, it's going to be a dominant Verstappen season. So that's the way it looks. It's pretty obvious. Yeah.
Arman, your thoughts?
I mean, Ferrari have clearly said they're not there to win the championship. So, I mean, that's given it away, hasn't it? They might have a very good car, but I guess, like Naren said, as the season unfolds, Red Bull seem to just have a stronger package overall in every aspect. So, it looks their way. I'll be very surprised if, Ferrari pull the socks up and, as a whole team, give them a challenge for the second half, which will only make it more exciting for the fans and for everyone else. But right now, it looks like a Red Bull show.
Yeah, I think the most exciting thing on TV right now is the Formula 2 championship. We have a lot of drivers going for it. Of course, we have Jehan as well.
There as well.
Yeah. So,
third in the championship.
Yeah, that is pure racing, right? So that is so fantastic to watch all these young guys fighting it out. So,
Santosh, are you obligated to support Red Bull? See the Red Bull logo on you. You're a star fan?
I'm not obligated, but... I'm totally in line with what Naren was saying because I feel that what he said is more than just the race. And I love Lewis for who he is. So, of course, everybody has opinions about that. But like he's saying, yes, of course, in the four-wheel aspect, it is growing. And in two wheels aspect also, motorsport is growing because as you see now, there's TVS and now there's Hero. And also the adventure segment of the market is being catapulted because with the Dakar Rally taking its center stage now. And it's only 5% in India, and it's actually 25% in the world in terms of what the market is. And it's definitely going to grow. And I see a lot of possibilities that are going to happen in India with this segment of racing and motorcycling.
If you could just tell us, our audience, about the crash that you had and what how dangerous it is totally. Because a lot of people might not know what happened there. And if you feel like, if you can just share some inputs, I mean some...
Yeah,
of
so
the
yes,
trials
I mean,
and tribulations
the, yeah,
you
the talking
went
point
there.
Is the fact that I crashed 2 years ago, I think. I think the thing that I can tell you about my crash is I don't remember anything. I don't remember that crash. I don't remember close to 2 years. Even my family, some people in my family, introduced themselves to me. It's kind of come to that state because it's not a mechanical injury. So that aspect, of course, even now, I'm pretty much every day is a process and a stage and recovery. And of course, my goal is to come back to race the Dakar. And that is who I see myself as an individual, as a person. And so yes, I'm definitely going to be back racing, and that motorcycle gives me life. So that's what I like to do.
The floor is open
just
for questions.
Just for everyone here, there is a documentary made on Santosh's crash by DW Network.
German,
it's a German network.
Television.
You have to watch it to see what he's gone through, and hats off to him. You know, and I'm sure you'll make it back into the Dakar. Yeah.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, everyone, for joining us. Hope you enjoyed. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.